Good morning, Edgewood Congregational Church, and welcome to virtual Edgewood. This is the 19th Sunday after Pentecost. We are fast closing in on the end of Pentecost and edging toward Lent in about 6 weeks, actually. So time is flying, and I hope that you're enjoying this very long weekend, the glorious weather that we've been having. I think we're going to have some rain this week, which are all of our yards are really needing. But before I start the service, I want to thank Cindy and Carol and Pat for all their hard work around the food drive this past Wednesday. The contributions are greatly needed. Keep on giving through the month. You've had notice from Pat about where you can leave some of the canned goods, and once a month we'll take them over to Transfiguration Church for the Edgewood Patuxent Food Pantry. Please join me in worship. In the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Gather at the mountain of God's holiness. Today is a day to celebrate God. Gather aware of those you left behind to be here. Today is a day to stand in the gap between God and God's children. Gather to share God's presence. Today is a day of transformation for us and for God's world. God, join us, please, now in this sanctuary as I represent our church and in all the homes where our congregants live. Living God, at times you seem so distant, help us know you are near. At times we stray, welcome us home. Standing in your presence, we know there are other people we could be with. Help us bridge the gap between your presence and the people we love. We pray in the name of Christ who lives with and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our confession today offers some opportunities for personal reflection and confession. So after we say, Lord, have mercy, we'll just pause and allow you to reflect on each petition. God pours blessing upon us even as we choose to go our own way. God is present and seeks to bring healing and wholeness to all. Therefore, I invite you to confess all that would separate you from God or one another. Let us pray. When we have fashioned idols of our own desire or worship the temples of our own tradition, Lord, have mercy. When we have denied our invitation to the banquet of love and justice, or failed to extend the invitation to others, Christ have mercy. When we have adorned ourselves with worry rather than joy, or failed to be gentle, knowing you are near, Lord, have mercy. My friends, praise be to God. Our sins are forgiven. God's steadfast love endures forever. Praise God. Our first reading today is from the book of Psalms, Psalm 23. God is my shepherd, I shall not want. God makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. God restores my soul and leads me in right paths for the sake of God's name. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of God my whole life long. The second reading is from the letter to Philippians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Odoia, and I urge Sintichi, be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, I will say. Rejoice! Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything be prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, who surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the peace of God will be with you. Our COVID confinements are teaching us much about living in close quarters with our loved ones. Never have we spent this amount of time together, forming pods, families who once went separate ways throughout the day are now working and studying in the same space. Busy couples who once left each other in the morning, returning at night exhausted, now labor together from home. Our quarters, once framed for the early mornings, evenings, and weekends, now are serving multiple purposes 24/7. You know, one day I hope we'll look back at this COVID experience and feel thankful that we have this time with family and other loved ones in our designated pods. Nevertheless, living in community is challenging at the best of times and a horror show at the worst. Just putting COVID aside, we find competing needs, clashing wills, and different goals, all leading to chasms in communications and wounded egos. And so it was with the fledgling Christian gathering in Philippi. Paul visited them during his travels throughout the Roman-occupied Mediterranean world. The reading is wonderful because it sheds light on the shape of these first Christian communities. Paul knew well Philippi's Christian community members. He stated, "Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord and his way, my beloved." He wrote to them, most likely while in prison elsewhere, because he'd heard of frictions, divisiveness within the congregation. He learned immediately that two leaders of Philippi, pay attention to this, two women, Eudoia and Syntyche, are at odds with each other. No, Paul spoke of two women leaders in the congregation. He had worked with them and was distressed to learn of a rift between them. Paul testified, saying, "Yes, and I asked also my loyal companion, help these women, for they had struggled beside me in the work of the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life." Paul honored these two women as co-workers, as laborers in the field with him on an equal status. Now, we do not know the nature of the disagreement. Paul did not go into details about the quarrel. He did not try to mediate their argument. Instead, he enlisted the rest of the community around them to help these women because, like the others, their names are in the book of life, as he said. Paul then asked the community to rejoice, to pray, to give thanksgivings, and to tell God their supplications. He encouraged them not to worry about anything. In God's peace, they will be protected. And then in this passage at last, Paul gave them a higher call, a higher purpose on which to set their hearts. He said, "Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you." He told them that through holding their higher virtues, the Philippians can keep on doing. Don't stop. Stay the course. Paul's mentorship of this community is exquisite and reminds me of a few things that I forget in the day-to-day struggle of being focus on the difference between how we once were and how we are now. We focus on the differences between the red ink on the budget lines that we see now and when those, you know, final budget lines have black ink. The leaking rooms and the falling plaster in our buildings, the inability to afford full-time ministers, the small Sunday schools, and the fading influence of religion in the society, dare I say, even the fading respect for religion in society. We don't tend to do much rejoicing, as Paul encourages us to do. Ministers such as myself tend to think we have to have the answers to all the whys and wherefores of the problems facing our congregation. What big egos we have. No one can have the answers to that. And yet congregations tend to look to the minister for all the answers. When disagreement erupts within our communities and their leaders, we think we have to solve the problem on a micro level, like trying to work out what was the problem with those two women, and then that would make the whole thing better. But instead, we don't look at the macro organism. We do the work we do, we keep on moving forward as individuals, but not as a whole. That's what Paul is asking us to do. To look at this as a whole being, together, not as individuals. Paul asks the others to help the women fighting, not let them go off and decide who's going to win the argument. No, this is a collective process. Today, when arguments prevail in community, more often than not, one person leaves to find another place to belong. Oh, that we've seen this happen how many times, over and over again. In large part, this is how our Protestant denominations were formed, out of disagreement theologically or ecclesiastically. That's why you have first, second, third, fourth churches in some New England towns in particular. Paul would have little to do with such fracturing, although he understood it as a human nature. Rather, his point was that living out Christ's message in our world, we cannot stop the forward movement with the problems of the budget, the red ink, the ability to afford a clergy, the lack of young children for our church school, and the deteriorating buildings. Those are micro problems, not the macro organism. Our community must rest on our ability to rejoice, he says, to pray, to give thanks, to say out loud our petitions to God, and to keep on doing. Paul would care about the influence of the church in the world, not because of politics or sociology. Rather, Paul cared about how we live out what is true, what is honorable, what is just, what is pure, what pleases, and what is commendable. He wanted us to seek excellence in the Spirit. This is where I think we study. We focus on the things of the faith rather than the spirit of our faith. No doubt we have worries. We have a lot on our backs. We have much to decide. We live in a world that cares less and less about what we do on Sunday mornings, as I've said, does not have patience to work out matters of the Spirit, needs to press a button on social media for instant gratification, is unable to sit still to meditate, to pray, wants learning to be instantaneous rather than a process of trial and error, fears failure, whatever that may be, and desires immediate answers for our world problems. COVID is teaching us that nothing is solved immediately. That is what is happening to us here in Cranston, because it's also happening globally, that this virus has not only invaded our physical beings, but also our economy, our day-to-day habits, our ability to be mobile, how we seek comfort with each other, by seeing smiles or frowns, or even the ability to hug. COVID is invasive and pervasive. So why should we rejoice, as Paul suggested to the Philippians? I think the answer is in our ability, our church, our Christian community, our ability to do the one thing the rest of the world has a hard time doing. Praying, sharing what we know of the Spirit, petitioning to God for our needs, and understanding what is God's time and not our own. We will live beyond this COVID crisis, changed, but we will make it through. There will be a vaccine. We will be able to move around without masks at some point. We will be able to hug each other and shake hands. We will be able to go where we choose. Children will be in classrooms, and people will fill churches. Restaurants will be ready to receive us. Workplaces will open again. Yet we will be changed. Yes, very changed. We will find each other. Paul's words are as a guide for us through time, through the challenges of different visions, through times of grief. Paul rings out these words today. Rejoice and give thanks. Because our purpose in this world is to keep what is good and true moving forward. As Paul says, just keep on doing. Amen. The prayers of the people today are a beautiful prayer written by a woman named Sally, and it's posted on a site called Eternal Echoes. Through light and shadow we are led. I follow through the ins and outs, the ups and downs of these days. When our hearts are failing, when our spirits rejoice, when we can barely put one foot in front of the other, still you beckon us on. When we stumble, you support us. When we can go no further, you carry us through light and shadow. In death's dark veil, on the mountain peaks, you lead us through tangled webs, on rocky ground, on smooth paths, through light and shadow, you lead us. We follow. May we never walk alone. Today we pray for the well-being of our church in a time in which we feel that what we were is slipping away. Instead, we are asked to rejoice and to look ahead, to keep on doing, to keep on giving God's love. We pray for all those who are in hospital or at home suffering with COVID. We pray that they may be healed and that an answer to this virus can be found. We give thanks for all who labor hard in labs everywhere to find that answer through a vaccine. In our own community, we pray for Janet and Janet, Kay, Joe, Joyce, a friend of Bill and Dee's, Michael and Brenda. And now join me in the prayer that Jesus taught us 2,000 years ago. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done as it is in heaven, as on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Holy One, accept these gifts of prayer and thanksgiving, and multiply them so that the wonder of your love and the justice and peace may be known throughout the world. My friends, now go forth, strengthened to do the work of Christ, standing in the gap, extending the invitation to the eternal banquet, rejoicing in God. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, and don't worry about anything. The God who created you, the Christ who redeems you, and the Spirit who empowers you is with you today and evermore.